there is a new social media website, and it is called Sue. And this is something that aims to be a competitor to Facebook. So a lot of problems with Facebook as well as YouTube, and it's the algorithm. It's what you see and it's what you don't see. Sue promises to be an alternative to that, and it's a lot more user-friendly when it comes to adding friends and finding people of like minds. And already in the last couple of days, there's a number of new individuals that are viewing my content and viewing my posts. So if you're looking for an alternative to Facebook, you might want to check out sue.co. And my particular page is sue.co-alex_Ansary, highlighted right there on the screen. So we will now start with local news before we get into our main subject matter of the evening. Now I'm going to have to go ahead and do a little bit of adjusting here. We are going to start with this headline. Police shoot wrong man when responding to gunman on the run in Vancouver. Police officers who responded to a tip about a wanted gunman on the run did not open fire on the wanted gunman, but the person who dialed 911 to report him in the area. The shooting occurred on Halloween morning as police conducted a manhunt across Southwest Washington for John Kendall, 59 years old. Kendall shot his neighbor, with whom he had a court appointment regarding a civil dispute that morning. During the manhunt, a citizen called police at 9:30 a.m. reporting a suspicious car parked on the edge of a wooded area off of Blandford Drive next to a gravel turnout. The car turned out to belong to Kendall. The citizen had also parked his car in the gravel turnout near Kendall's car and remained at the scene after hanging up with emergency dispatchers. Police officers rushed to the area, and when they arrived, they encountered not Kendall, but the citizen who dialed 911. All the more reason to be very careful when you call the police for help. In the next headline, Portland principal put on paid leave after domestic violence arrest. You see, domestic violence doesn't just happen to women, it also happens to men, but it's usually underreported because of the shame associated with it, including sexism directed towards men who are victims of domestic violence. You know, when they say, just be a man and take it, that's sexism. Don't show emotion. Don't show that you have feelings. That is all sexism. Portland Public Schools announced 2 weeks ago that it placed the principal of Kelly Elementary School in the Lentz neighborhood on paid administrative leave on October 30th, but it offered no other details, telling the Portland Tribune that it was a personal matter. Now it's clear what happened. Portland police arrested principal Marty Diaz at the school's district headquarters at 501 North Dixon Street at 11:48 a.m. on October 30th on allegations of assault in the fourth degree and domestic violence. She was then booked into Clackamas County Jail, said Sergeant Pete Simpson, a Portland police spokesman. Police records said the arrest stemmed from an incident on October 22nd in Milo Melver State Park in Estacada. Reached by phone, Diaz declined to comment, "I don't want to talk to you." Now an update on the street tax. Portland Street Fund says Business Alliance very concerned with new $46 million proposal, lack of public vote. During Monday morning's press conference at Portland City Hall, Mayor Charles Hales and Commissioner Steve Novick said they had tried to strike an appropriate balance in charging residents and businesses under a $46 million tax plan. While the duo stated that nobody would be universally pleased with the plan, they believe the revised proposal is a significant improvement over the one pulled in early June on the eve of a scheduled vote. These individuals do not care what happens to them or how the public feels. They are in for either one or two terms. This is a business, and they are there not to represent the people of Portland, but the powerful business interests, the powerful real estate interests that truly have influence over the city. Far more influence than the voters. And that includes the bondholders. They are the ones that pull the strings at City Hall. Now let's get into some other headlines. But before we do that, I believe we have a video entitled Professional Cuddler Opens Up Shop in Portland. And this is relating to monetizing basic human affection. I made a statement on the show at least 4 years ago that in the future New World Order, due to the massive imbalance between men and women and the stage-managed war of the genders, you're going to see more monetization of sexuality, sexualization of the youth. Now we're seeing cuddling monetized. Only those with the ability to pay shall have a cuddle. I find the story to be very, very interesting. Go ahead and roll it.
Winter weather, I call it cuddle weather. Joining us this morning, the world famous author and cuddler, Samantha Hess, author and a professional cuddler, as we said, making a mark here in Portland and around the world, just out with a new book that we have right here, Touch, The Power of Human Connection. So good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to have you back.
Thank you.
So tell us about the book.
The book is really fun, actually. It has 19 cuddle positions to show people what some of the options are. It goes into the science and psychology behind touch, what it does for us and why, as well as chapters on communication and how to get across your wants and needs.
Yeah, so tell us, give us a couple quick tips on cuddling this this holiday season.
So one thing that people always think that they're nervous to tell their partner when they're maybe not super comfortable, and so they don't usually cuddle quite as
well. Oh, really?
Yeah, absolutely. So I like to recommend that people actually speak up when they're uncomfortable. Maybe try out the tandem bike. That's one of my favorite positions. It's very comfortable.
Now, you've named the positions. Did
absolutely.
You come up with these things?
Yeah.
How long did it take for you to come up with, oh, so such as this, like here is one.
Coming back to studio.
The pyramid.
Yeah.
So, you know, just describe this to me.
Speak up if we're a little bit uncomfortable. I'm uncomfortable with this obsession on monetizing human compassion and monetizing sexuality. It is unnatural, it puts too much focus on the dollar, and we need to start thinking outside the box of money, how much money a man has, how much money a woman has. Let me ask you a question, because I think cuddling is great, I think it's very therapeutic, and may be able to potentially prevent violent acts from people that have deep-seated emotional issues. However, do you think you're going to see this on a healthcare plan? If the government really cared about your healthcare, instead of pushing drugs and things of that nature, how about real therapy, where they have real counseling sessions where people can work out their problems by talking about them and getting real advice, therefore bypassing drugs that are there to give you an artificial, some way of artificially coping with feelings that are entirely natural. And so this is an issue that we're going to continue to look at, where all this is going, with man and woman divided and everything being about money. And this story hits the nail on the head. It's exactly what we're looking at, and we're going to see more of this, more monetization of sexuality, more monetization of friendships, more monetization of human compassion. And we need to remember that we need to be able to operate outside the box of the Federal Reserve dollar system if we in fact are actually human and not robots created by the Matrix. Also, Veterans Day took place the other day, and I was in the Hollywood District while there was a parade taking place, and we're going to play the next video with Otto. This is video of a van promoting and showing drones attacking innocent civilians in the Middle East, or those that they call terrorists or enemy combatants. Remember, whatever has been done to other people can surely be done to the people of the United States when we know that there are drones above our skies and that those drones can be hacked by our enemies. Go ahead and roll it. We have the UAS flight demonstration system, and it looks like they're glamorizing the drone attacks. For the most part, that have been conducted against innocent civilians. Of course, this is portraying them attacking quote-unquote terrorist institutions. But we have drones above our skies, and people that have different views on things here in the United States have been demonized since 9/11 for thinking for themselves. Not only that, but it's also come out in the news that the drones can be hacked by China. So this whole robotic system that's being put in place can actually be hacked. We got a guy laughing here. We're talking about mainstream news. What has been done to others can be done to us, because this isn't being done for the strength of the United States. So we've got a video here glamorizing all of this. We need to be on the watch for this. We don't need drones over our skies. Portland is not in danger, but our rights are in danger.
So these are things to contemplate as we move forward and closer to the staged managed Third World War, which could occur in the next decade between China, Russia, and the United States.
And that is a topic that we will be addressing tonight. Notice I didn't megaphone the guy. Notice I didn't scream at the guy. Notice I didn't insult the guy. I planted seeds. A person cannot unhear something once they've heard it. And it is important to speak out against the evils of our world because that is a part of being human. One thing I also want to note about that whole situation, the parade that took place, who wasn't present? I'll tell you who wasn't present. We saw little kids and we saw older dudes that are, you know, veterans of foreign wars in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and of course before. And you have the 90s, you have people that were representing that were in the first Gulf War. You didn't see younger guys that had served in Afghanistan and Iraq. There were a few, I did notice 3 to 5, but out of hundreds, you had the older crowd acting like they're tough with their motorcycle, represent, and then you had the younger crowd. It looked like a Russian parade, frankly, with the music and the schools that were there. And there's a lot of people that are saying and starting to wake up to the reality that you're not supporting the troops by looking the other way when record numbers of returning veterans are committing suicide. War crimes aside, suicide is serious business. And when you have a larger percentage of troops killing themselves, it's a representation of a sickness within the psyche. And people need to remember that. Now going into some of our other headlines that we have prepared. Obama urges net neutrality. Cruz calls it Obamacare for the internet. And I'm not a fan of Cruz, but in another edition of Outside the Box, we'll talk about this other charlatan known as Ted Cruz that may be one of the runner-ups in 2012 along with Rand Paul, who's hardly anything like his father in reality. But this article reads, President Obama has called on federal regulators to toughen proposed net neutrality rules for internet traffic, including taking the controversial step of changing the way the law treats broadband providers, so they are subject to stricter utility-like regulation. In a two-page statement and a two-page online video, Obama came out in favor of the toughest possible regulation of internet service providers on an issue that has flooded the Federal Communications Commission with a record of about 4 million public comments. Now, in another headline, you may have heard the local news. They are no longer arresting people for possession of marijuana in Multnomah County. But a UN official is accusing the United States of violating international law by legalizing pot. In the United States, decades-old marijuana prohibition laws are crumbling state by state and city by city. Colorado, Washington, Oregon, and Alaska have legalized marijuana for recreational use. Voters in the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., recently approved a referendum legalizing recreational cannabis. 23 U.S. states now allow patents to seek treatment with medical marijuana. With polls showing that a majority of Americans approve of pot legislation, it is clear that the issue has hit a tipping point. And so for those of you that think that the UN is honest, they're trying to fight climate change, they care about human beings, this is a human rights violation. And the United Nations, by the way, has their own One World Army that is very much linked with the NATO One World Army. And there's a lot of crimes that have been committed by UN troops throughout the world, specifically rape and things of that nature in Africa and elsewhere in the world. So it's important to understand the real UN versus the fake UN that most people believe is an institution that is here for our well-being, our safety, and peace on earth. Here's something for those of you that are Democrats that thought that our problems went away after George W. Bush left office in 2008. You can find many photographs of the Clinton and Bush family vacationing together. You can also see photographs of Putin with his shirt off in some cases, but pictures of Putin and George W. Bush vacationing together, although when Putin had his shirt off, he wasn't exactly standing side by side with Bush, nor have we seen him stand side by side with Obama, with Obama's shirt off. But Putin is definitely a populist misleader, misdirector at this time. We're going to talk a little bit about that tonight. So things are not as they seem in the geopolitical spectrum, but according to this article from NewYorkMag.com, George W. Bush calls Bill Clinton his brother from another mother. Bill Clinton has repeatedly joked that he's become so close to the Bushes that he is considered their black sheep son. And on Wednesday, he and adopted brother George W. Bush broadcast their affection on social media. Clinton tweeted a photo of himself reading W.'s book, 41, A Portrait of My Father, and teases the younger Bush with the hashtag, how are you still not on Twitter, as he did on President's Day? This time, W. had a response. And you can read more about that online. In terms of technological updates, we talk about transhumanism on the show. We have for years, the merger of man and machine. And I've mentioned autonomous cars coming to our city at some point in the future. After all, they had a conference on it in the summer of this year, which my friend attended. People from all over the world were in Portland talking about how they were gonna pull this off, connect vehicles to the iCloud system. And I have a suspicion that there's probably going to be some sort of DNA analysis machine available in these future cars. They'll tell you how you're feeling. They'll tell you, you know, oh, you need to drink more of this. You need to eat more of this. But we're talking about the ultimate surveillance tool, your DNA, not to mention the worldwide DNA database that all countries have access to. This is information that you should know. And we also know about IBM's history in Nazi Germany. And so you should find this article significant and relevant. IBM's Watson wants to examine your DNA with the help of pathway genomics. Consumers may one day be able to ask Watson for insights into their health. How much exercise should I get today? How much caffeine can I drink on Monday? These are questions you might ask yourself, not really expecting an actual response, but if IBM has its way, its Watson supercomputer will soon be able to supply the answers. In the next article, government agencies directly involved in most high-profile U.S. terror plots, and that also includes Portland, Oregon. You can look at the case of the Somalian who was accused of attempting to light a bomb or blow something up at the Christmas tree lighting several years ago. And then it came out that the feds recruited him. I believe he was over in Aloha or Hillsborough. They took him to Lane County and they taught him how to blow up a backpack. Total entrapment, a total setup. And then they terrified the people of Portland and then Portland joined the JTTF. Randy Leonard was one of the only city council members that claimed to be against it. Oddly enough, bad luck for Leonard. His daughter killed herself around the same time, oddly enough, at a gun range in Washington State while she was in recovery for heroin addiction. So a very strange story indeed on the local front. Let's go ahead and play video of what we're looking at here. Let me make sure that we are in order here. No, wait. Now we're gonna cover the McDonald's video. You are what you eat. Well, we'll play this without audio because there is just extreme profanity, but we're seeing a rise in violent activity at McDonald's. I'm actually seeing a rise in violent activity at the Wendy's at Lloyd Center. Actually, there are quite a few Caucasian men that were acting in a very violent manner. And I'm starting to find out there's a lot more person-on-person attacks in the Lloyd Center area. And so it's not necessarily a very safe place when the Blazers lose the game. We're seeing more Portlanders lose it when the Blazers lose. And I had a lot of people sticking their bug eyes out at me about a week ago when the Blazers lost. And there were about 30 guys that came in screaming. They were looking around the restaurant like they wanted to act like these two black women. Now, it's unfortunate all the racist comments that are posted on the RT webpage. This is not a racial issue. This is an issue that relates to what is in our food, what is in our consciousness. And with that, let's just play a few seconds of audio. And that is the end of the video. And we're gonna play one more video after this before going into our main subject of this evening. Some of you are familiar with Russell Brand. He's a populist, so-called revolutionary who wrote a book on the topic. And he's become very popular, and he's frequently on the mainstream media on a global level. And a lot of people are asking the question, is this guy a Pied Piper? Wasn't this guy married to Katy Perry? And there's also a lot of awkward things that he said, but he's really popular on the internet. And a lot of people think that if you criticize the cult of personality, that you're against the message itself. This is a YouTube channel called Troll Station, and they had a little fun with Russell Brand. Go ahead and roll it. You know, I could think of a few people in the alternative media that I think should probably have a similar response. Hey, I love alternative media information. I love learning things from other people. I love some of the things that I've learned from certain individuals, even though I'm not a big fan of their personality and specifically how they treat other people and how they engage in their business dealings. You know, there's certain people out there that would like to be their own JP Morgan, their own Monopoly Man, the whole spear being on top of the whole info war. But I think it's important to keep some of these personalities in check and remind them that we're all in this together, and it's not all about them being our alternative media fear. And so with that, we will begin the next phase of our conversation. For years on this show, I've been warning people that there are plans for a staged, managed World War III scenario. Unfortunately, some of the top dogs in the alternative media, as well as the mainstream media, are catapulting the propaganda that it's about the United States being against China and Russia over who is going to lead the New World Order. In reality, China, Russia, and the United States are all working together, and Western banks financed and were behind the Bolshevik Revolution, as well as the revolution in China. We see the United States funding Chiang Kai-shek and then putting their money behind Mao Zedong. So there's a deep history of China and Russia that most geopolitical analysts have never actually considered. So what we're seeing here on the table is confirmation of things that I've said for years. And we're seeing continuous mergers of the United States and China, greater global cooperation agreements on multiple fronts, including military transfer technology. We're actually arming our future enemies in preparation for this World War III scenario, in addition to allowing China to buy record numbers of properties throughout the United States. Congress isn't stepping in. They're not stepping in saying, wait a minute, this is actually a national security threat. They're actually are allowing this, and they're allowing even companies like Huawei, which is a cell phone company that's already been accused of espionage against the United States. They have a headquarters in Plano, Texas, and we have a video that talks about Rick Perry a little bit later. But let's go ahead and start with the latest breaking news that probably has many, many people out there celebrating. I'm gonna go ahead and pull up the audio on my computer. The breakthrough they've been waiting for, a deal brokered between U.S. and China strike historic climate change deal. The critics are already questioning whether China got the better end of this deal. We get our report tonight from our chief environmental affairs correspondent, Ann Thompson.
China's pollution problem is plain to see, obscuring tourist snapshots, forcing marathoners to wear masks, even the police. The government tried to clear the smog for this week's world leaders meeting by closing factories and banning cars as it did for the 2008 Olympics. Both had limited success.
The air itself is just plain thick, the worst it's been here in days.
Now, after years of dragging its feet, China is pledging to reduce pollution by taking action on climate change with the U.S. The U.S. and China, the world's biggest economies, are also the biggest carbon emitters.
Okay, first of all, what I want to mention, and we'll keep playing the screen as I bring down the audio. Climate change is real. The question is, what is the real cause? When you know, and there's that number 2025 again, that period of time that I keep referencing, which is the peak of the next solar cycle. Oddly enough, there's a pattern of the peak of solar cycles being around the time period that we see countries invaded and men being sent to war. We see false flags. We see things like 9/11. Now we're in solar maximum. Take a look at world events right now and tell me there's not a connection between solar maximum and staged, managed wars or conflicts. Climate change is real, but notice they're getting away from the global warming terminology. And when they misinterpret the data, when they skew the data about how the sun affects temperatures on Earth, it's a common sense issue. If you don't realize that it gets warmer in the morning when it's no longer dark and the sun comes up, you have a cognitive impairment. And that's the end of the conversation. You are cognitively impaired if you cannot make a connection between the sun and climate change. Do you know that we have seen an increase in solar activity in the last several months and that we're at a double peak in the solar cycle? Have you noticed the weather change in Portland? Did you notice the winds the other night? Do you notice how many times you read about tornadoes and earthquakes and storms? Do you notice when people are just going off in Portland? And we're reading more stories of crime, including sexual assault. Are you noticing more conflicts between people during these time periods? I personally do and have for years, but yet this is an issue that is still a blind spot for many, many people, and the sun and its effect on consciousness, human beings, world trends, even agriculture, and so many other things, it's an issue that I'm going to come back to in the future. But focusing on this headline, the United States and China, which together account for more than a third of all the world's greenhouse gas emissions, have negotiated a sweeping agreement to cut emissions drastically by 2030, a deal that President Barack Obama called a major milestone Wednesday. So you're gonna see people applauding a connection between China and the United States on a deeper level. Going to our next headline, Obama, China should not underwrite global order, not undermine, should underwrite global order. U.S. President Barack Obama says the United States wants China to be a partner in underwriting the international order, not undermining it. We also have other headlines saying new world order to fight climate change beginning many, many years ago. He made the remarks on Monday during a news conference in Beijing, where he arrived to attend the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, the APEC Summit. Our message is that we want to see China successful, Obama said, ahead of his scheduled meeting at the APEC gathering. We also have the G20 in Australia. But yet, in reality, just 90 companies cause two-thirds of man-made global warming emissions. Chevron, Exxon, and BP. You remember the BP oil spill, don't you? Among companies most responsible for climate change since dawn of industrial age. So even within the official view and theory of global warming, which was their initial terminology that they started to use, just 90 companies cause two-thirds of man-made global warming emissions. Everything else that's taking place is about control. Oregon's plan to tax you by the mile is about control, and that's not even officially about climate change. That's about double taxation, triple taxation. They already charge you high registration fees. They already charge you an arm and a leg to get a license, but now they want to tax you by the mile in Oregon, and there's a pilot program that's going to start in the summer of 2015. They're going to test on 5,000 volunteers, and they're going to go from there. While World watches APEC and China sends a message, President Obama's former Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates, could very likely give the president some insight into what's happening this week in China as the world's political leaders meet in Beijing while representatives of the world's militaries gather in the southeastern city. Gates met with military leaders in China in January 2010 for what he believed would be a friendly and necessary dialogue. Close to 6 months prior to his trip, he had played down the threat of China's J-20 stealth fighter jet, saying it would not be in service until the 2020s. Again, back to the 2020s, 2025. They're preparing for the next decade of world war. They're preparing for the decline of the United States. The United States is being demonized. Our government's been hijacked. We have a black eye before the whole world. They've taken away due process. Our political system is entirely corrupt on the Democrat and Republican level. This is all by design. Even the truth about 9/11 is all by design. You know, Russia and the United States could have said something after 9/11 in terms of the unanswered questions. They didn't say anything, and the steel from those buildings went to China. Meanwhile, Russia had troops outside Afghanistan in the weeks prior to 9/11. If you think this is just about the United States, you've got another thing coming. The Chinese regime is again playing the same game. While the attention of the public and the global media is on the 2014 Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation APEC Summit in Beijing, the Chinese regime is hosting an arms show that has the attention of global military and security leaders. Meanwhile, as the United States imposes sanctions on Russia, all it does is bring China and Russia closer together and stronger and stronger and stronger. This is not by accident. China to set billions, to pump billions into Russian real estate construction. Chinese capitals help boost Russian stock of affordable housing by 25 million square miles by 2018. Now, there's been a number of headlines. I mentioned this last week. U.S. and Canadian F-22 fighters scrambled to intercept six Russian military planes near Alaska. These headlines are becoming all too common. And while I don't think World War III is going to begin in the next few months or the next few years, I don't think they're going to be pulling this off until the next decade, global tensions will increase from here on out. And what it will do to the average Chinese person, Russian person, citizen of the United States, people in Europe, is push people further and further into a nationalistic box where they think the other country is solely to blame for the world's problems. So you have a sophisticated global propaganda machine that is operating worldwide, targeting its custom demographics, the Chinese people, the Russian people, the people in the United States. They are turning us against each other in a day and age where we have realities of mutually assured destruction. And that may be very well the plan, to bring down the world's population through a stage-managed world war and then bring China, Russia, and the United States into the one world government structure that they've been planning for a long time, even prior to 9/11. Take a look at this from CNN. See the source? We're not making this up. This is actually happening. You really are here. No, seriously, pinch yourself. You're actually here right now. You're not dreaming. Russia flexes muscles with long-range bomber flights near U.S. shores. Russia plans to send long-range bombers to the Gulf of Mexico in what appears to be Moscow's latest provocative act, manner in its increasingly frosty relations with the West. Now, I got to go ahead and clear these out. Vladimir Putin suggests Britain and France were responsible for the Nazi march into Europe. And while that may be very well true, there's also plenty of war crimes that the Russians have committed, whether we're looking at certain countries in Eastern Europe and the trafficking of women, or we look at what the Russians did to the Afghan people between 1979 and 1989. Russian President Vladimir Putin has suggested that Britain and France were responsible for the Nazis' march into Europe. Russian warships, by the way, are also heading into Australia at this time. And we're going to go ahead and bring that up here. This is something that we're seeing. And instead of loading all the articles at once and causing my computer to crash, computer's like, oh my God, are you serious? Relax, computer. We'll just take it one step at a time. Russian warships heading to Australia. Prime Minister Tony Abbott has described the convoy of heavily armed Russian warships cruising international waters towards Australia's north as part of freedom navigation. The Prime Minister was adamant in his discussions with Russian President Vladimir Putin to date had focused on responsibility over the downing of Malaysian Airlines flight MH17. Asked whether he would bring up the warships with Mr. Putin when he arrives in Australia for the G20, Mr. Abbott said those discussions had focused on a crime. Now, a couple brief mentions about Putin. When you see RT and other networks like that use sex to sell a concept, use sex to sell a president, you should know that something is very much wrong with this particular equation. You shouldn't have to use sex to sell a politician. But that's exactly what is happening. You can look at Russia today and you can see scantily clad women that are actually washing cars for Putin and getting naked and things of that nature. And the reality is people respond to things like that. So we have a couple videos here that we're gonna play in just a little bit. But before we do that, I wanna cover a couple things relating to fighter jets. A lot of the technology that has been created in the United States has been outsourced to China beginning years ago. You can look at the Clinton administration, missile technology transfer. About the same time the Monica Lewinsky scandal took off, ChinaGate, you can Google ChinaGate, Look it up on YouTube. It was a scandal that came out when Republican lawmakers, as well as perhaps some Democrats, were concerned that Clinton was giving away our military secrets. Since that time period, it has only escalated. Not only that, Donald Rumsfeld was the head of a corporation that sent a light water nuclear reactor to North Korea. Believe it or not, that is actually a fact. You can look it up for yourself. This is from Press TV. China has officially unveiled a sophisticated stealth fighter in a move believed to enhance its military status in the region. And here's one of the latest headlines. Why the United States sent a C-17 to a Chinese air show despite concerns against the Pentagon. The United States military sent a giant C-17 cargo plane to an air show in China this week as a way to strengthen its relationship with the People's Liberation Army there. And this is also something that is in the news at this time. China hacks U.S. weather systems satellite network. And this is coming from the Washington Post. Hackers from China breached the Federal Weather Network recently, forcing cybersecurity firms to seal off data vital to disaster planning, aviation, shipping, and scores of other crucial uses. The intrusion occurred in late September, but officials gave no indication that they had a problem until October 20th. It's a cover-up. There's actually a cover-up taking place within our own government as to what happened recently with China hacking in to this weather system. China's internet chief accuses the United States of hacking, but says talks unhindered. They will continue to merge and globalize and work together, yet at the same time developing greater weapons of war, even weapons that can incinerate human beings and perhaps more. All of this is more and more is taking place. From Reuters, 80% of Chinese government websites have been attacked by hackers, with most of the assaults launched from the United States, according to a top Chinese internet regulator. One more before we go to the next video. China declares Occupy movement illegal. President Obama says Hong Kong people should decide. Now think about this. It's called Occupy in China. You don't think that's just a little bit influenced by the Pentagon, by the United States? And let's just go back to Occupy and think about, you know, all the people chanting together. I say, we should all act like a collective and say the same things in a chant and dance. And then we saw Occupy fall on its face because of that collectivized thinking, and a lot of people abandoned Occupy that were genuine activists. That's why it didn't last. There are still people involved in Occupy and good people, and I give those people respect. Unfortunately, there are some people that have been involved with Occupy that are pushing their own agenda. So this is important to know that China is just a little bit perturbed of the U.S. influence in the Occupy protests. Here's something that I want you to know. This is very important, and I covered this on my YouTube channel several years ago, starting in the year 2012. Chinese cadets visit League City, Texas for their annual internship. You see, the Chinese are already operating in the United States as police officers. All this started back in 2009 and 2010. The following video is from the League City YouTube channel. Go ahead and roll it.
Another year and another opportunity for two great countries and two police forces to make a difference. For the second year in a row, the League City Police Department has hosted 9 police cadets from China's Zhejiang Police Academy. The cadets are required to complete 4 years of training, including a year-long internship at Sam Houston State University. As a part of their internship, the cadets spent a week with officers from the League City and Alvin Police Departments. League City was chosen to participate in the program for the second year. Police Chief Mike Jez says it's a great opportunity for both League City officers and the Chinese students.
So it's really exciting, I think, for our officers to have an influence on future policymakers and a national police agency that's certainly a world power.
The program focuses on community policing, a practice that League City Police Department is known for.
We wanted to make sure that we had communities that had strong histories of community-oriented policing, as well as communities that were where the police were trusted and had good relationships with the community. And in this area, Alvin and League City both have very long histories of both good, effective community relations, as well as community-oriented policing. So we thought this would be a good fit. Also, quite frankly, the hospitality of the people in those communities was another reason for choosing.
The students received several hours of classroom training. They took a tour of the Galveston County Courthouse and received a lesson in the American Court System from Judge Lonnie Cox. They also toured the League City Fire Department and had some interaction with fellow emergency workers. As a part of the program, they also received arms training and did ride-alongs with League City police officers to experience community policing firsthand. The cadets aren't only paired with officers for training, they spend 24 hours a day with officers and their families, an experience neither officer nor student will ever forget.
I enjoy a great time in my host families, and the police officers are being so nice, and I had great experience during patrol.
It was just a good experience, two different cultures coming together, we both learned from each other, and we got a lot out of it. We built a relationship. The cadet we sponsored last year, we actually Facebook with him, email him, he calls his mom and dad, and we still have a good relationship with him.
Before we go out tonight, so I'm going to try to conclude tonight with a little bit of finesse, coming back to studio. That is League City, Texas. Take a look at my monitor. This is League City. This is where it's at right here, where my cursor is circulating, right along Highway 45. I want you to notice and take note that it's near the Texas coast, or the Gulf of Mexico. Remember, we just talked about Russian ships or Russian aircraft about to start doing patrols in the Gulf of Mexico. There's also other articles you can read about greater military cooperation between Mexico and China. I don't mean fake reports saying China's already here with a massive base that nobody can prove, some BS to take us off of the real truth. There actually is military cooperation between Mexico and China. So look at League City, and they are in close proximity to, here we are, Houston. Now, we have more info on Houston. Police cadets from China may shadow Houston officers. I want you to see this, and I want you to ask yourself, who else is telling you about this information and bringing you all these articles together pretty much in one breath? I can't really think of any, but I want to give James Corbett from the Corbett Report credit where credit is due, and I recommend you watch the video that came out last week if you're on the web called China and the New World Order. It's all about how China is a part of the New World Order. China is not against the New World Order, and this is something that we have to share with the people of the world. Taking a look at a few pictures here. Okay. So going to the next video, this is entitled Governor Rick Perry, China Loves Him. We're only going to play about a minute or two of this and then we'll come back.
Texas Governor Rick Perry is the political centerfold for some of America's hardcore conservatives. Mixing politics with code terms to emphasize his Christian views, he preaches less government, less taxes, and advocates policies near and dear to the hearts of the ultra-conservative political right. But others might see Rick Perry as a lapdog, a stooge, a callboy for global big business, and the atheist communist dictatorship known as the People's Republic of China. There's a reason the Chinese government-owned Tianjin Pipe Group built a $1 billion oil pipe factory in Corpus Christi, Texas. There's a reason the Sovereign Wealth Fund of China, the communist government's vehicle for foreign business deals, has invested more money in Texas than any other state in the U.S. Governor Perry's actions hardly align with his political rhetoric. What he says and what he does are two different things. Perry was the prime mover behind the Trans-Texas Corridor, which was to be the first phase of the NASCO North American Super Corridor, commonly known as the NAFTA Superhighway. Texans by the thousands vehemently opposed the Trans-Texas Corridor.
Taking family farms isn't family values.
Rick, keep your hands
Skip forward a few minutes in that video.
It would be the holy grail of espionage against the United States.
Thank you.
Two giant Chinese telecom companies, Huawei and ZTE, have been relentless in their efforts to sell their equipment to the U.S. phone and data grid. Huawei and ZTE have been cited numerous times by our national security experts and intelligence services around the world as suspected espionage fronts for China's People's Liberation Army. It's a charge both companies routinely deny. It would be news if they admitted it. Huawei and ZTE have chosen to establish their U.S. headquarters in Texas. For those who may think this commentary is picking on
Plano, Texas,
Rick Perry,
which is pretty much the Lake Oswego or the Beverly Hills of Dallas. And from that point on, we're actually now going to go to a screenshot. All that information you can look up for yourself. Republic of Singapore Air Force unit activates, going to my monitor. Mountain Home Air Force Base, Idaho. After 8 months of planning and preparation, the Republic of Singapore Air Force passed a significant milestone when a new fighter training squadron activated here during a ceremony May 18th. And I wrote an article about this back in 2008 and 9, how the Air Force of Singapore that enjoys close ties to China is training at Mountain Home Air Force Base in Idaho. Now, going to the next report, Alex Ansary calls out Chris Matthews for demonizing Stuart Rhodes at RNC Day 2. We don't have time to get into that. Go to the next video, though. Photos released of Russian U.S. drill in Colorado 2012. And go ahead and mute the audio on that and skip forward about a minute. And I'm talking with my friend Donald here. This is when I was in Texas at the UNN studios, just outside of downtown Dallas, Texas. And skipping forward a minute to get to the pictures, we are talking about a drill in where the Russians were invited by the United States. This isn't fake disinformation news. This is real. And very under-discussed in the alternative media. Certainly, I don't know of anyone at Occupy talking about this. This is going to have certain consequences down the line. And so they practiced using drones to search for those labeled enemy combatants in the United States. And that's going to be the resistance to the UN troops. Going to the next video. And as we get ready to conclude here, go to the last one, which is Joel Skousen, starting at the 550 mark, and we'll play a couple moments of that, and go ahead and roll it.
Boeing and Zvezda Strela, the weapons lab
and,
of Russia.
If you look at the American soldier
fighter
on the
what was the
left
purpose
here?
That was to make sure that the transfer, yeah, the technology of that fighter,
you have two videos rolling,
Russia, and that's where it gets
very
to,
stern
to China.
There's also other things we've got on that deal with controlling their populations, like sound weapons. I remember reading that last year.
We've developed sound weapons that have, you know, very effective at mass control.
Intel made them a supercomputer too.
Yeah, and help them actually tyrannize their people. We allow weapons and prison technology to help them in their gulags. But this isn't strictly, you know, critics on the left of the globalism, and we appreciate their friendship. I come from the libertarian side. But critics on the left view this only as greedy capitalism. This is all for money, but it's much deeper than that. We didn't
it is
go
much
Iraq.
Deeper than that,
well,
and now we are going to close
Bush.
The program.
Well,
a lot of people say, hey, why even bring up these issues? If we can highlight and document that the coming stage world war is a manufactured event, we can prevent people from actually joining the future armies of death by educating them with facts and helping them to get outside of their nationalistic worldview box. And with that, I bid you farewell. And this is now the conclusion of Outside the Box number 330 for November 15th, 2014. Until next week, I'm Alex Hanser reminding you that the path to the ultimate truth still lies within. Take care, stay safe. Good night.